are boundary-pushing change agents. We do what it takes to make things happen together. It's our collaborative spirit that sparks creativity and pushes us to think beyond ourselves. We're scrappy and unabashedly enthusiastic about our passions and projects. We are hardwired for the havoc of change. We know it isn't easy, that theories can fail and world changing can feel futile. But that's the calm before the brilliant storm. The breath you take before you break through. Small change comes from asking why. Changing the world comes from asking, why not? That's the question we ask everyone, from freshmen to faculty. It's the question that fuels us to find the next new. The question we ask you, why not change the world?
RPI Hockey is back. Contact the Houston Fieldhouse box office at 518-276-6262 or boxoffice@rpi.edu to watch your engineers in action this season.
It's the most historic conference in college hockey. It's a battle night in and night out. ECAC Hockey, an iconic conference home to 12 of the most prestigious universities and programs in the world, and showcasing the best student athletes in the sport. Top-notch facilities and arenas, incomparable traditions, passionate fans, alumni who go on to become elite professionals, leaders, and champions. ECAC Hockey, there's no experience like it.
We are boundary-pushing change agents. We do what it takes to make things happen together. It's our collaborative spirit that sparks creativity and pushes us to think beyond ourselves. We're scrappy and unabashedly enthusiastic about our passions and projects. We are hardwired for the havoc of change. We know it isn't easy, that theories can fail and world changing can feel futile. But that's the calm before the brilliant storm. The breath you take before you break through. Small change comes from asking why. Changing the world comes from asking, why not? That's the question we ask everyone, from freshmen to faculty. It's the question that fuels us to find the next new. The question we ask you, why not change the world?
Thank you. Second period about to begin here at the Houston Fieldhouse in Troy, New York, in the heart of New York State's Capital Region. The score after 20 minutes of play, the homestanding RPI Engineers 3 in the visiting Mercyhurst University Lakers 1. Alongside the coach, Dan Fritch and Dan Ball, joining you here on ESPN Plus for the first of a two-game weekend set here at Houston Fieldhouse. We're live tonight, we're live tomorrow. Same time, same channel here on ESPN Plus. The two teams continue to do battle as the Engineers open up their regular season and non-conference schedule. Well, Coach, there was a lot to like about that first period. We move into a middle period. We'll see the two teams once more. Not a whole lot to add on to, but is there anything else you'd like to see from this Engineers team in the middle period?
No, I think they're doing a great job. They're clogging up the neutral zone, so Mercyhurst can't get any speed attacking the offensive zone. And they're moving their feet on the forecheck, creating some turnovers and capitalizing.
John Beaton will take the opening draw opposite Carson Breer at the center ice logo here at the Houston Fieldhouse. Good crowd on hand. You can hear both the band and the student section that's directly behind the Engineers bench getting into it, and we're underway here in the second period. Engineers going from left to right across your screen here in the middle 20 as Brendan Booty goes in on the forecheck, but he's upended. Sent to the point, kept in for the moment by Hallbauer. One-handed, he's able to keep it in the zone, but it escapes over the line. We'll have a hand pass called against the Lakers, and the faceoff will be back in the offensive end for RPI.
Yeah, Breer tried to just bat that puck out of the zone and ended up on the stick of St. Ange. And hand pass is called.
Breer, a goal in his two games against Ohio State last weekend, so looking to pick up where he left off, had the primary assist on the lone goal for the Lakers. Shot by Surdy. That one gets blocked out to center. The three goals in the opening period for the Engineers coming from Ryan Massey, Jake Gagneau, and Jacob Lee, the last of which was on the man advantage as Beaton avoids a checker, finds a man trailing, it's Gagneau, his shot deflected into the corner. The power play last weekend for the Engineers went a combined 1-for-5. That one goal coming towards the tail end of the scrimmage against Colgate. Far side point shot deflected and a kick save made by Tyler Harmon, who's looking to rebound here in this middle period. Of the eight shots that he faced, three went past. And while Jack Watson in the cage to our left for the Engineers went 7-for-8 combined in that first period. Skated over the line, wrist shot deflected to the corner. Nick Strom lays the block on the shot. Sent to the point now, cross point. Townend will skitter it into the near side corner. Klee advanced for Heidemann, who had to absorb the hit from Townend and will instead take it back behind the net. Here is Klee, takes it to the line and fires it over the net of Harmon and into that far corner where Heidemann meets it. He takes a big hit and is taken all the way down to the ice as the puck is flipped high in the air out into the defensive end for the Engineers. Walsh at the line, hits the brakes, will regroup, has McIsaac to his right, but shoots, and a save made. Harmon will hang on and get a faceoff just over 2 minutes gone by into the second period, 3-1 lead for the Engineers.
Nice quick shot by T.J. Walsh. He's using the defenseman. Townend is a screen. Got it up on Harmon. He was able to hold on for the faceoff.
Herman, McIsaac, and Walsh. Line for Dave Smith's group as Herman tries to tie up off the draw. It's controlled by the Lakers, and McCallion will advance it out to center. Big hit coming after the puck was gone from Burns. That was Herman who laid the boom. Roy Herman did not see action at any point last weekend. In total, 54 games in his career, 33 games last year, 3 goals and 3 assists, lays another big hit. And in part allows his team to get it as far as center. Never a bad thing to have a player with that kind of physical presence on offense, at least giving defenders something to think about as the puck wouldn't sit for T.J. Walsh.
Yeah, you'll certainly be noticing when number 16 is out on the ice.
Near side boards, McIsaac battling two white sweaters. sent across the defensive end. Burns gains the center line and sends it the rest of the way. Watson stops for Ardanaz, and now Mazzotti advances it, but his pass is too far ahead for Brackett, taken the other way. No option but sending it in deep for Tommy Bannister, the freshman making his career debut for the Lakers this evening.
RPI themselves having trouble coming through the neutral zone.
Smolinski, it's deflected in by Mazzotti, so no icing. Harmon will knife it off of the official. Brackett's the one that's the beneficiary of it. Evans sends to the point for Serdi, nearly lost the puck, instead sends it in deep. Brackett a backhand feed, that one gets blocked. Evans unable to corral, but Serdi steps in from the point, applies a little bit of pressure. RPI still keeping it in their offensive zone. Evans back for Brackett, stick lift there, doesn't allow it to connect. Slap pass finds Evans, sent towards the goal, but well wide. Chipped to the line and deflected out by Esposito, but Hallbauer will flip it up in the air and back in. Eric Esposito, a transfer from New Hampshire, in total 8 transfers on this Lakers roster, so one of those teams benefiting from the transfer portal. Here's Kyler Head, finds a trailer, and a shot goes high. Briere was the one who found it, now a shot from the point. That one goes just wide. Centering feed, Esposito, and a save. Jack Watson finds that one, a couple of chances there, and a flurry for the Lakers. But Watson, the defense stands tall to keep the lead at 2.
Yeah, Head had a golden opportunity there to put that puck in, sitting in the slot, but again, I think it just jumped over his stick and he couldn't get it away.
Face off to the left of Watson with just under 5 minutes gone by in the second period, a 3-1 lead for RPI. Face off sent to the far side boards, deflected out to center there by Mashey. Once more now it's Heidemann, and after a few sticks fighting for it, it ends up on the stick of Heidemann again, but only for the time being. Cross ice fast finds Bisson. Now it's St. Ange into the zone, looking to send a pass across for Briere. Now it does connect with the right-handed centerman on this line, but instead it's Jacob Lee. After a turnover forced, here is Mashey, finds the trailer. Heidemann on goal, blocker save, all the way back to the point for Strom. Klee once more. Now it's Heidemann on the near side, takes a big hit there from Bisson. Pass deflected there by Mashey. Here's Heidemann in the far corner. A lot of ice traveled by Austin Heidemann here in this shift. Klee leaves for Lee. Now it's Klee once more. They'll rhyme for this season. Klee's shot gets blocked. And after all is said and done, it's sent over the defensive blue line and in, but we're going to have a stoppage of play and a penalty. This time it's going to go against the Engineers. It appears as though Jacob Lee is the guilty party. And just over 5 minutes into the second period, we'll see the Lakers power play for the first time.
Yeah, he kind of got wrapped around on the Mercyhurst forward. Lee did, after leaving the puck for the defenseman. It's called for 2 minutes. This will be an important power play. Well, actually, an important penalty kill for RPI. Mercyhurst will be looking to get back in this with a power play goal.
The Engineers gave up 2 power play tallies to the Colgate Raiders on Saturday. They did not face a penalty kill in their game against Toronto last weekend. Knifing in front of the goal, kick save Watson. Back to the point now for Townend. He finds a man on the near side. That's Fedulov. Georgi Fedulov for Esposito. Now Townend at the point. All the way across once more, trying to find Esposito. That puck wouldn't settle for him. Instead, it finds Jack Brackett off the glass and all the way down, and the Engineers will get a change. The penalty kill last season, one of the nation's best, clicking at 88.8% for this Engineers team. Last season for the Lakers, a power play at 22.2%, 18th best in the nation. Beaton on the far corner, sends it to the line, but not out. Kept in, one winds and fires, rather, in a save. The shot coming from the point in Owen Norton, but it was deflected on its way to the net and ends up being an easy stop and cover for Jack Watson.
Mercyhurst was ranked 7th in the preseason poll out of 10 teams from Atlantic Hockey.
A lot of creativity being used in those rankings, as that's exactly where they finished last year. finished with a conference record of 10-12, along with one shootout win, which is being adopted across college hockey, and it's kind of a lot of fun. Beaten at the line, he'll backhand it the rest of the way. Are you a fan of the shootout in college hockey?
I don't mind it. Yeah, I mean, it's entertaining.
From a broadcasting perspective and from a fandom perspective, you're right. And as you're looking to recruit more fans into your game, as that one gets up into the Lakers bench, we'll have a whistle and a face-off in the neutral zone. If you're looking to recruit more fans, of course, some hockey purists will say it's a gimmick, but it is a fun way to get your student sections on their feet, and that's half the battle at the collegiate level.
I think I'm more of a fan of the three-on-three than I am the shootout.
See, ultimately, I'm with you, and there's the argument out there, and I think it's a good one, that if you extend the three-on-three past the five-minute mark, even to 10 minutes, you would have so few games that would end in a tie, especially if you knew that the tie was the result, that it would end up being worthwhile. As McCallion shoots and a save by Watson, he will hang on.
Watson just happened to go down to the butterfly there because he had the Mercyhurst forward, Dalton Hunter, right on the doorstep trying to take his eyes away. And as we mentioned, just during the break, I like Coach Godkin's look there. No tie. Of course, he's in his 35th year, so I don't think he's trying to impress anybody.
Not necessarily going for the big promotion he's been waiting for at this point.
No, but he does look good.
He does, absolutely. As a one-timer from St. Ange, just turned aside. Rebound controlled behind the cage. Here's Briere on the near side. Briere sends below the goal, trying to send in front is Hunter. That one's turned aside by Watson. Puck is deflected up and goes out of play with 3 seconds to go on the penalty against Jacob Lee. We'll have a face-off down below. But you're right, and you made this point as well while we were in the break. We just had insightful conversations before we went on the air, as is typical in broadcasting. The change came, you estimated, around the time that COVID hit and certain teams were playing, others weren't, but that's kind of when you saw the metaphorical tie start to loosen, right?
Yes. And not just from a coaching perspective on the bench, but, I mean, even in the NHL now, I mean, there are some teams that just travel in sweatsuits and they don't dress up for the away games anymore. I mean, you're spending all that time in the bus. We used to, you know, you'd have to put your suit and tie on leaving the bus to go into the game, but once the game was over, you'd get back into your sweatsuit again.
I'm always a fan of a good balance. You know, you always want to look respectable, so even if you are doing the sweatsuits as a deflection, there's a weird bounce there that nearly caught Jack Watson napping, but he was equal to the task. It would have gone wide anyways. Heidman finds Mashey at the line of backhand feed in for Lee, who is out of the box. So the power play now 0-for-1 for the Lakers this evening. The Engineers were able to cash in on their first man advantage. The deflection in front by Lee off the shot from Jack Agnew. Agnew's on the near side now. He knifed it up into the air, but it's taken the other way by at the center line, and it's taken the other way. Here is Mashey, cross zone, wrist shot, deflected up and out of play. Couldn't find the name I was looking for. It was Dustin Garagosh, the sophomore out of McKees Rocks, Pennsylvania, who caught me by surprise. And after all is said and done, a deflected puck out of play. We have a faceoff in the offensive zone for the Engineers with just over 8 minutes gone by.
Just on that last rush by RPI, I would have challenged had a Goldman score, because that looked like it was a tad offside.
A good thing to note, we are right on that blue line, so we would know better than anybody, as Ardanaz knifes to the net. Deflected wide of the net, but Beaton will get on that one in the near side corner. Beaton on his backhand, sends to the point. Klee tried to send it on goal. Delayed penalty coming up against the Lakers. It's touched up in front of Harmon's cage. And just a minute or two after the penalty expires and Jacob Lee returns to the ice, now the Engineers will get their second shot on the power play here.
That's the Juloff. He took a whack at Beaton when he was carrying the puck out of the corner. And certainly a slash, which the referee did not miss.
8 minutes, 36 seconds, the time of the penalty against Fedulov. Power play on the ice for the Engineers, 1-for-1. And the man who scored the goal, you can see him on your screen, Jacob Lee. He will also be taking the draw. Lee, Walsh, and Gagneau with Smolinski and Agnew, the unit out here for Dave Smith, the unit that scored the power play goal last period. Agnew steps in on the far side board. Smolinski will corral. Now it's Agnew. Steps toward the middle. Gagneau and Agnew trade places. Stepping in. It's deflected off a skate and in the net! Well, it looked like the ultimate target was Walsh on the far side, but why not send it off a skate and in the net? And that's exactly what Jack Agnew did. It's 4-1 Engineers.
It's going to go right off of Lee there. Right off his skate. I mean, watch, he turns.
Well, it'll be interesting to see the determination on this one, because you can learn a lot from who leads the celebration line, and it was Agnew, but I would think Lee would end up getting credit for it. It went off the skate of Garrett Dom, who was the one who kind of threw his hands in the air like, why me? But as a result of that, we've had a change in net, and Matt Lenz will take over, the sophomore out of Grapevine, Texas. Sent from the point, tested early, there is Lenz. Lori Cerdy, the shot from the left point, Lenz will hang on. Again, we mentioned him earlier on in the game, as Lenz the only returning goaltender on this team. He played a grand total of 10 minutes last season as a freshman. Gave up a goal on 9 total shots that came against New Hampshire last year. Product of the Steinbach Pistons in the NJHL. So Lenz takes over, close the book for the time being on Tyler Harmon, who did not have a night to remember after playing both games against Ohio State, as that one's chipped up and into the bench for the Engineers. Love a stoppage and a faceoff.
Yeah, that's right. They lost 4-2 and 4-1 to Ohio State. And speaking of Coach Godkin before the game, he said Ohio State is definitely legitimate.
Another team in the red that has some legitimacy to them, as so Mercyhurst coming off of a very tough test there indeed. So Lenz will man the net for the Lakers for the time being, as the Engineers have extended their lead to 3. Stepping in is Hallbauer, kick save by Lenz, rebound cleared by Townend to the near side boards, but not out. Hallbauer once more was looking for a backdoor feed. Cerdy protects the puck, but good pressure coming there from St. Ange, gets it out past the defensive blue line. Lori Cerdy finds Herman. He's unable to corral the puck. It deflects off of it and into the near corner. Townend can only advance it as far as TJ Walsh, rather. Getting my Walsh mixed up, as that one's popped up by Townend and off the scoreboard. And that'll get us a stoppage of play and a TV timeout here with 9:56 to go in the second period. The offense firing on all cylinders in the early going for the Engineers. They lead 4-1 over Mercyhurst. You're watching RPI Engineers Hockey on ESPN+.
For the love of the game, the team, or for two, Recovery Sports Grill. At Recovery Sports Grill, you'll always have courtside seats to exciting live sports coverage. And for outstanding loyalty perks, join our Hall of Fame, Recovery Sports Grill, serving up smiles every season.
RPI Hockey is back. Contact the Houston Fieldhouse box office at 518-276-6262 or box office at rpi.edu to watch your Engineers in action this season.
.56 to go, second period here in Troy. A 4-1 lead for the Engineers of RPI over the Lakers of Mercyhurst. Dan Ball, Dan Fridgen with you here on ESPN+. Delighted to be part of your Friday evening here in the Capital Region and beyond. If you're just joining us, it was a 3-1 lead for the Engineers through 20 minutes of play, and they've added another. Now we'll have a quick conversation Not entirely sure what the stoppage was there, as everybody was kind of looking at everybody else going, well, are we ready? And now apparently we are. Faceoff sent into the near corner in the defensive end for the Lakers. It's sent as far as Agnew. McIsaac had it for the moment. Deflected past Agnew by Esposito, allowing the Lakers to get it into the offensive end. To a side they battle. McIsaac's able to find that centering feed and take it to the line. He finds a trailer. It's Walsh. Now it's Agnew on goal, deflected. Never got to the net. It's taken back the other way. Norton sends across the neutral zone right across the center line, but Ardanaz is the one who's able to corral that in the defensive end. To the line and back in by Townend. He takes a hit after the clearing attempt. Here's McIsaac. Was able to plant and find a pass, and this pass through the neutral zone did not connect. It'll instead go for icing. The goal coming on the power play, it is indeed awarded to Jacob Lee, who was camped in front of Tyler Harmon's net. The same two assists, Jack Agnew, Jake Gagneau, as the previous power play goal for the Engineers. So Lee from Agnew and Gagneau extends the lead to 4-1 and also closes the book on Tyler Harmon's evening here in Troy.
Well, you can see the difference in execution already in RPI's game. They've had 13 shots on goal and they've had four goals.
Here's Brackett into the zone, hits the brakes and shoots, and a save by Lenz. The rebound skitters past the near side post. Klee steps in, nice move, finding a man in front. He was trying to find Mazzotti. Deflected to the point, Strom keeps it in. A kick block there, Strom keeps it once more. But eventually on the third attempt, it's brought over by Keenan Stewart. Stewart the one on this puck on the near side. A hit laid there by Strom. The puck deflects up off the end glass behind the net of Jack Watson, who has not been overly busy in the second period. He's seen a lot offensively, as that one deflects, might have caught iron. A rolling puck that eluded Watson. It's now sent below the goal, centering feed, deflected away with the stick of the Engineers' netminder.
That was definitely crossbar material.
Stepping in from the point there is Waugh. First sustained pressure that we've seen from the Lakers in quite some time. Battle ensues in the far corner as Brackett and Evans, the two Engineers fighting for it. It's sent to the point, kept in by Reifenberger. He walks the line, shoots on goal, missed the net wide. Sliding his way into the picture was Fedulov. The puck sits in front of Watson before it's knifed to the corner and picked up by Mazzotti. Off the near side, glass and out to center. The Engineers will sprint their way for a change as a deflected pass didn't connect with Reifenberger. Smolinski finds Beaton through center. It's Booty on the near side on goal. A shoulder save by Lenz. Deflects up and remains in play as a centering feed wouldn't go for Beaton. Sent back to the point for Serdy. Now it's Smolinski on goal. Deflected kick save. Rebound loose in front. Beaton fighting for it, but it's taken the other way by Reifenberger. He's on the right side and sends a pass back to the point. One-timer and a glove save. Fedulov, the one trailing late, who took the one-time attempt off the feed by Reifenberger, but a clear lane for Watson to make that stop and hang on.
Nice play by Reifenberger. He knew he was going to get clocked, but he dropped that pass back, took a hit, and made the play.
Saves on 17 shots for Jack Watson so far for the Engineers. He's been very good in handling what has been thrown his way. Sent to the line for Bisson. That one's blocked in front by Hallbauer and taken out of harm's way by Lauri Sertti. Backhand feed finds Lee. Now it's Heidemann on the right. Here's Heidemann, a shot and a save. Lenz unable to corral the rebound, allowing the Engineers to regain possession for the moment. Sprayed to the point where Hallbauer chips into the near corner. Mashi and Bisson battle for it. It's the latter who was able to pull it away. Advanced for St. Ange, and now here is Briere. who goes right over the Engineers logo at center. Briere drops the shoulder but is knocked back behind the net. Good defensive positioning there from Hallbauer, and Booty will take it out of harm's way. That's Nashi, rather. Now it's Lee once more. Here's Heidemann. Shot. That one's deflected up and over the cage. Briere, a backhand flip a little too far in front for Dalton Hunter. And instead, it allows the Engineers to get possession back in their own end. Good feed there by Walsh. Finds the speedy McIsaac. He shoots and scores! Pretty feed through the legs of Walsh. Finds McIsaac, who drops his shoulder and sends it five-hole. It's 5-1 RPI.
Well, a great play by McIsaac. You're going to see here on the replay, he doesn't stop skating once he receives that puck. A lot of guys are just coast to the top of the circle and then take the shot. He kept skating, and while he was in stride, he let the shot go, which is a tough read as far as the release point for the forward to read it, and went five-hole on Lynch.
McIsaac's first of the year. A lot of speed, like you mentioned, Coach, there to be able to open up that kind of room for yourself. Didn't try to do too much, and hand up from the official. That is a delayed offside, so we'll have a face-off in the neutral zone with 5:23 to go in the second. Again, didn't try to do too much on that play as McIsaac is going from his left to his right. You saw the tail end of that one there. Instead of trying to pick a corner, you see that the goaltender is moving with you, send it five-hole. That's a goal scorer's goal right there.
Definitely. Yep, and I think he might have caught Lenz. McIsaac, with not being able to read when the shot was coming, caught him by surprise.
There was another shot earlier in that shift that Lenz made the save, but the way that the rebound deflected off of him so drastically to the near side, it was clear that he didn't exactly see it all the way in. He did happen to get his body in front of it. So it's clear right now, you know, Lenz is coming into this game cold, and he didn't play either game last weekend as Jake Gagneau comes off of the ice looking a little bit worse for wear as the pass is deflected below the goal. Esposito takes the hit from Hallbauer. Hard to tell exactly if what Gagneau was dealing with was anything injury related or if it was just a blown tire, so to speak.
I think he lost a blade, one of his skate blades. So blown tire would be correct.
The more fun way to say it, yeah, he lost his skate blade. And blown tire is the one that I hear on the broadcast all the time, so we'll have a little more fun with it. But good to know, and hopefully that is the case indeed, as Evans has it at the center line, sends it the rest of the way. Under 5 minutes to go, second period, 5-1 Engineers. The offense has come to play in this season-opening non-conference game here at the Houston Fieldhouse. Townend chips through the center line. He finds Keenan Stewart, who does the rest of the work on the clear. A reverse from Surdy finds Brackett, and now Heidemann. He backhands the rest of the way. He'll take on four white sweaters as the rest of his team changes. Townend skates it out of harm's way. He was met there by the physical play from Lee in front of his own bench. Kind of just beginning his line change for him anyways. That's exactly what he was doing. Here is Heidemann. Over the blue line, finds Mashy, but the pass a little too much in tight quarters. Agnew was spilled to the ground as he came in and tried to get in on the offense. Then he gives a quick shove over to Jake Bonnet, so it appears as though Bonnet was the one that upended him there just below the goal.
Yeah, you got a good piece of him too. Agnew's a little upset going to the bench.
Long pass to the line, knocked away. Nice stick play there by Nick Strom. Strom has been playing the majority of his shifts here with Mason Klee, but taking one with the freshman Nick Ardenaz. Lenz hits the brakes on that one, tried to find McIsaac in front. He didn't even hear the footsteps of Walsh as he was coming from the near side. Sharp angle shot turned aside by Watson. Rebound skitters behind the net. Walsh reverses, looking back for Klee, who's out there with Strom now. The puck ends up in front of the cage, and that's where Jack Watson will say no more. And he'll hang on.
Well, they've got Mercer's 18 shots, but nothing that's really been terribly important and in great scoring situations.
It's true. You know, very honestly, that last chance, the shot coming from below the faceoff dot is very indicative of what the offense has looked like for a large portion of this. It's been very opportunistic. That's how the Lakers scored their first and currently only goal. Booty chips for Beaton, who has a man coming late. Beaton on goal and a save. The rebound was in front. Wouldn't sit for Nick Strom, who jumped in on the offense. Gagneau takes a hit from Briere, who steps in. It's now one forward v. one forward. Backhand pass deflected to the corner by Serdi with the active stick. Norton gloves it down below the blue line and fires it back behind Watson's net. Serdi the first one there for the Engineers. His backhand pass just a little far in front of Beaton. Now here comes Esposito. His shot deflected up, ramps up the stick, and out of play. We'll have a stoppage here in the second period. A minute 44 to go. The Engineers, a 5-1 lead here at home.
Well, RPI is doing a good job keeping the pressure on. Minute 44 left here. They'll have won the second period as well as won the first period.
Engineers are coming off of a season in which they won 18 games. Conference record of 10-12, sixth overall in ECAC hockey, which is always a very tough conference on the men's side, especially on the women's side this year, with I believe seven teams in total making the top 15 on the women's side in their national polls. That backhander was just out of the reach of the lanky Sutter Mazzotti and goes for an icing, and the players will skate the length of the rink and they'll try it again, this time to the right of Jack Watson. Mazzotti and Bannister on the draw. It's controlled by the Lakers. Bisson's shot goes intentionally wide. Here is Hallbauer, who skates his way below the goal. Hallbauer finds Evans. It just wouldn't sit for him. A backdoor pass looking for Mazzotti. Shot on by Hallbauer. Save, rebound, and another stop. Lends his best stop of the night thus far. Brackett finds Mazzotti below the goal. He goes one-on-one against Garagosh. Brackett battling once more. Hallbauer will send it below the goal. As we have 1 minute to go in the second period, it's been all Engineers through 39 minutes of play here at the Houston Fieldhouse.
Yeah, that was freshman Evans that had an opportunity there on the rebound to put that home. Great save by Lenz.
So we're in something that I just learned about in a conversation post-game last weekend. The Moe's final minute here in the second period. If the Engineers score, everybody gets a free taco at the local Moe's, so everybody is really rooting for an Engineers goal at this point here at the Houston Fieldhouse as it's sent to the far corner for Heidemann. Almost responding to the stage here is Dave Smith with his top line out on the ice right now, but more just looking to apply pressure than get free tacos for the fans. Serdi sends it towards the net, too far behind Jacob Lee. Now it's Mashey in the near side. His pass deflects to the far boards. Serdi will step in from the point and hit the brakes. But his pass is turned over. It's brought the other way by Burns on a partial two-on-one. He shoots, kick, save, rebound loose in front. He won't get a chance to get the shot away as the period comes to a close. So no tacos, but many goals anyways. It was 3-1 after one. It's now 5-1 after two. And more than anything else, you were looking for just a continuation of a lot of things offensively for this Engineers team. But really, firing on all cylinders right now for the home team.
Yeah, there's no question. And they were fortunate there that the clock ran out, because that was a pretty good opportunity by Mercyhurst. But with two periods in the books, RPI has been dominated this game thus far.
Dave Smith finishes things off, discusses with Ryan Mashey before both head towards the room. A lot to like, but still a lot more to build on, and we'll tell you more about that when we return. We've reached the end of 40 minutes here at Houston Fieldhouse. The score of the Engineers, 5. And the Mercyhurst Lakers won. Back with the third period in a few moments. You're watching RPI Engineers Hockey on ESPN+.
We are boundary-pushing change agents. We do what it takes to make things happen together. It's our collaborative spirit that sparks creativity and pushes us to think beyond ourselves. We're scrappy and unabashedly enthusiastic about our passions and projects. We are hardwired for the havoc of change. We know it isn't easy, that theories can fail and world changing can feel futile. But that's the calm before the brilliant storm. The breath you take before you break through. Small change comes from asking why. Changing the world comes from asking, why not? That's the question we ask everyone, from freshmen to faculty. It's the question that fuels us to find the next new. The question we ask you, why not change the world?
Hi, I'm Andy James at Rensselaer Honda, and this is my buddy Bo. Looking to sell your car or truck? We want to buy it. Are you looking for a great used car? We have a huge selection. That's why Rensselaer Honda has been your Honda dealer for 44 years.
Thank you.
the most historic conference in college hockey. It's a battle night in and night out. ECAC hockey, an iconic conference home to 12 of the most prestigious universities and programs in the world, and showcasing the best student athletes in the sport. Top-notch facilities and arenas, incomparable traditions, passionate fans, alumni who go on to become elite professionals, leaders, and champions. ECAC hockey, there's no experience like it.
For the love of the game, the team, or for two, Recovery Sports Grill. At Recovery Sports Grill, you'll always have courtside seats to exciting live sports coverage. And for outstanding loyalty perks, join our Hall of Fame, Recovery Sports Grill, serving up smiles every season.
RPI Hockey is back. Contact the Houston Fieldhouse box office at 518-276-6262 or boxoffice@rpi.edu to watch your Engineers in action this season.
We are boundary-pushing change agents. We do what it takes to make things happen together. It's our collaborative spirit that sparks creativity and pushes us to think beyond ourselves. We're scrappy and unabashedly enthusiastic about our passions and projects. We are hardwired for the havoc of change. We know it isn't easy, that theories can fail and world-changing can feel futile. But that's the calm before the brilliant storm. The breath you take before you break through. Small change comes from asking why. Changing the world comes from asking, why not? That's the question we ask everyone, from freshmen to faculty. It's the question that fuels us to find the next new. The question we ask you, why not change the world?
I'm Andy James at Rensselaer Honda, and this is my buddy Bo. Looking to sell your car or truck? We want to buy it. Are you looking for a great used car? We have a huge selection. That's why Rensselaer Honda has been your Honda dealer for 44 years.
Periods down and one to go from the Houston Fieldhouse here in Troy, New York, in the heart of the Capital Region. The score after 40 minutes of play, the RPI Engineers, the offense, well, firing on all cylinders right now. They have a 5-1 lead over the visiting Lakers from Mercyhurst University. Alongside the coach, Dan Friggin, Dan Ball with you here on ESPN Plus. Thanks so much for making us part of your Friday evening here on ESPN Plus. We'll be back with you tomorrow evening, also beginning at 7 o'clock as these two teams do battle once more. And of course, you can catch every single game right here on ESPN Plus. You can catch them right here at the Houston Fieldhouse as well, rpiathletics.com for tickets and more information. We move towards this third period, and Jack Watson gets his crease ready. He is to our right. Matt Lenz will return to the crease for the Lakers. He took over for Tyler Harmon, who had a less than stellar game in net for this Lakers team to begin. But how much of that, from what you saw, was a goaltending issue versus maybe just a defense that wasn't ready for what the Engineers had to offer?
I think it was a little bit of both. I would say that on the first two shots that Harmon faced, they were both stoppable.
Okay.
So, and that got him behind the eight ball real early. Yeah, they did get one back, but then, you know, one goes off the foot of Lee, or actually the stick of Lee. And he looked a little shaky based on the number of quality shots that he received early.
A fair point indeed, and now he will watch for the time being as Kyle Hallbauer has it below his own goal, leaves for Lori Surdy. It is Beaton, Booty, and Gagnon to begin things here in the third. Booty shoots and a save by Lenz. He was able to corral that one. While we have a moment, an update on the scoreboard going around the ECAC and more. First, a update on the RPI women's team. They are tied at zeros through two periods out of Gaganis Arena against Boston University. Amanda Rimpato, 26 for 26 in saves so far. As that one skitters back towards Lenz, he'll cover up once more. In total, six ECAC hockey men's teams in action, including the Engineers tonight. Through two periods, St. Lawrence leading Merrimack 2-1. Clarkson leading UNH 2-0 after two. Tie game between Colgate and Northern Michigan, one goal apiece. Quinnipiac leading Boston College 2-0 as puck goes down and will be in icing against the Lakers. Union College Dutchman trailing the UConn Huskies 3-1 after two periods. So a lot of ECAC versus Hockey East going on around these two conferences this evening, but we have a bit of ECAC versus Atlantic Hockey going on here in the Capital Region. Face off to the left of Lenz. Just 40 seconds gone by. Minutes would be quite something. 40 seconds gone by, third period. Battle in the far corner, taken the other way by McCallion. Deflected and kept in for the moment, but it will spray over the defensive blue line. That's where Lee has it. He'll backhand it the rest of the way. Jacob Lee, 2 goals, 2 assists for 4 points through two periods. A remarkable beginning to the regular season for Lee through 40 minutes of play.
He's the reason why they're 2 for 2 on the power play.
He's been that presence in front of the net, which is extremely valuable, deflecting a shot from Agnew from the point and then a backdoor feed as that one is deflected and goes wide of the net. He was in front and he got a skate or a stick or some bit of Jacob Lee on that centering pass. He was the one that made it 5-1, and Coach Friggin is exactly right. He made it 2-for-2 on the power play, so it's been nice to see after a 1-for-5 cumulative weekend last weekend. Mashi at the blue line, sends on goal. Lenz will deflect into the near corner. And the rest of the offense for the Engineers will go for a change. Tipped into the zone there by Burns, and that's where Nick Ardanaz will backhand it through his legs. Walsh tried to steal it away, but it's taken by Burns, kicked away by Watson. Townend steps in from the point and the bench, whipped on goal by Stewart, save, rebound popped up and past the near side post. Townend advances below the goal. Played on the far side, looking for Stewart. That was deflected away, and here comes Walsh. Walsh has a partial break. In on net comes TJ Walsh. A backhand and a save by Lenz. No rebound, and the sophomore netminder out of Texas is able to hang on.
Well, Wash definitely having some good team speed. And he gets the wheels going on this one. And then looks like he was trying that old forehand to backhand. Forehand to backhand, five hole, but Lenz wasn't having any piece of that one.
Face off will be to the left of the netminder Lenz, who in that second period ended up 7-for-8 in relief of Harmon. Seems as though maybe Walsh might have learned a thing or two from his line mate, James McIsaac, who was able to go five hole on Lenz back in that second period. Near side, Esposito gets it near the line, now to the line. Jack Brackett knocks it free. Now here comes Mazzotti. It's those two with John Evans. Evans looks to center a pass. That one's turned over and taken the other way by Bannister. Near side in front of the RPI benches. Bannister a shot. A blocker save made by Watson up in the air. Evans knifed it down first. A hit laid there by Mazzotti. A hand pass ruled. And a stoppage of play here just over 3 minutes into the third period with the Engineers in a four-goal lead.
Looked like that shot was tipped there, the last one on Watson. I think he caught it in the forearm as opposed to just above the blocker.
Beaton and Briere on the faceoff just outside the defensive end for the Engineers is controlled by the Lakers and sent in deep. Big hit laid there by Bonet. He upended Brendan Booty, snapped his stick in the process, and icing ruled against the Engineers. A bit of a car crash there in front of the RPI bench.
Bonet likes to throw the body around. He had caught, I think it was Agnew, early in the second period.
Bonet standing at 6'3", 195 pounds, and it was Agnew who was up on the offense and probably regretted it after that. And Agnew kind of gave him a quick what was that for shove. But here is the aforementioned Bonet, snapped on net, stick save made there by Watson. It goes up and out of play. Faceoff will be in the defensive end for the Engineers. He was second on this group with 59 blocks last year. The penalty minutes, nothing too crazy, just 16. But again, there's physical and then there's over the line, and that's when you see guys start to rack up penalty minutes. So if you're able to play that physical game but keep it above board, so to speak, I mean, that's a valuable person to have on the back end.
No question, especially with the size that he has. He's not afraid to step up in the neutral zone, as you just saw.
Taken to the line and muscled over it there by McCallion, but Jake Gagnon was able to knock it away and send it right back. Off of the stick of Briere, Heidemann sends it off of the near side boards. Here comes Lee, back for Heidemann, but the puck wouldn't sit for him. Two on two the other way with Heidemann as the back checker, but Briere, a few too many moves near the blue line. He sends the rest of his line mates offsides.
Yes, he did send them offside. When you want, when you're attacking the zone, you got to get that puck across the blue line, and then you can do all the stick handling you want, as opposed to when you're approaching it.
Faceoff controlled by the Engineers. Lee was the one who won that one. Popped up in the air along the near side. Nick Ardanaz was able to knife it down. Mashey over the center line. Good move there to open up a little bit more room for himself. Here's Heidemann on the right side. Toe drag shot on goal and a save by Lenz. He finds that rebound. Good move in tight space there by Austin Heidemann, who's looking to light the lamp against his former team. But Matt Lenz, for the time being, says no.
Yeah, it looked like he was trying to go top shelf on him, but Lenz was right there for the task.
Heidemann, 27 points in 38 games last year. That was tied for the best on this Lakers team.
I was just going to say, it started off with a nice breakup by RPI through the neutral zone.
A lot of value to be able to move that puck through the neutral zone quickly. That's a lot of times, you see any team in college hockey can fall victim to it. When you're not able to move the puck quickly, when you're not making those passes quickly, you'll get teams that just dump it right back in on you and you're not really able to get anything going offensively. It's no way to get an offense started.
That's right. And just end up spending all the time in your zone. By the time you get to the neutral zone, you got to get a line change.
Faceoff to the left of Lenz is controlled by the Engineers. Sent to the left side for Surdy from Smolinski in a shot right into the gut of Matt Lenz, who will hang on. There was a line change while we were conversing. Now Rory Herman will lean in to take the draw. The Engineers so far, well, through two periods rather, leading 25-15 in the faceoff department. John Beaton has been chief among the faceoff winners to this point. Puck loose behind the goal. Engineers tried to advance it in front for McIsaac, but instead it's taken the other way through the neutral zone, brought in by Stewart, who absorbs a hit from Lori Surdy. Meanwhile, Jack Watson absorbs the shot from Stewart.
Yeah, pretty easy shot to handle coming from the outside. Just wanted to make sure that he held on to it because he had one of the Lakers on the doorstep waiting for that juicy rebound, which didn't come.
For some reason, that's a term that will always make me laugh. I don't know why. The juicy rebound term. I heard it as a... From where I was, I watched Boston Bruins games. Well, that was my team. And Jack Edwards would always say, juicy rebound. And so it always makes me laugh. It's a great way, but you know exactly. If you're in the hockey circles and you hear the term juicy rebound, you know exactly what a goaltender just kicked out. So it works. It definitely does work.
Well, that's because you got somebody sitting there licking their chops just waiting for it.
Norton met by Evans into the near corner. We're just over 5 minutes gone by in the third period. 5-1 lead for the Engineers over the Mercyhurst University Lakers. These two teams will do it again tomorrow at 7 p.m. Same time, same place, same channel. Hope you'll join us. Here is Hallbauer, who's met by two white sweaters and knocked to the ice accordingly. Mazzotti, a backhand feed to space, but the space leads to Adrian Bisson and the Lakers. Good step there by Hallbauer. It knocks the puck loose near the blue line. Chipped around, but only as far as, well, that same Hallbauer. He's been everywhere.
I'm just looking at that stick in the neutral zone. It's a right-handed stick. There's quite the bend in that thing. Oh, it was broken, that's why.
It'll get you every time. Oh, man.
I was looking at the blade thinking, wow, that's pretty illegal.
Like, I thought, you know, between Alex Ovechkin or Artemi Panarin with the toe, I've seen it all. But, hey, you never know. Somebody could be shooting with an absolute hook on this team. Wasn't sure who dropped it at the time. Beaton's backhander finds Gagneau. Now it's brought ahead by Booty and Beaton once more. 1v3, he comes with a trailer. He hits the brakes on the far corner. Beaton wheels, shoots, blocked, up in the air and over the offensive blue line. Arenas will be forced to regroup. Screams coming abound as the Lakers were going for a change, but the Engineers weren't able to quite advance it quickly enough. Taken to the line and brought over center by Hunter. Now a race for the puck, and the race is won by Arenas, says the linesman in charge, and that'll be an icing against the Lakers.
You know, that's one call that I think has gone by the wayside is illegal stick call. I don't remember the last time a coach has called an illegal stick on the opposition.
Have you ever asked for an illegal stick check?
Never.
Really?
Yeah,
okay.
Never. But and I was wondering why in lacrosse you see these players, especially in the women's game, they'll drop their stick.
Yeah, that's the rule. Right after a goal, got to drop it. It's fascinating.
Yeah, so what could be illegal about that?
My understanding is it's something about the netting on it. It can only be a certain depth, as Watson swallows that one up.
Oh, okay.
You can only have a certain depth of pocket in your stick. That was the word I was looking for.
Gotcha.
Before it can be. Now, granted, I don't know how an eye test can really measure that. It would have to be pretty drastic, I would think. But the only illegal stick check I can remember, and I wasn't even around to see it, was, I believe it was Marty McSorley. It was Kings Canadians.
That's correct, yeah.
90s. Yep. And I know it ended up changing the series. That much I do know, as that shot is kicked away by Watson. Chipped off the boards and out to center.
I believe the coach was Jacques Demers.
Sent near side corner. So that's the one famous one, and you wonder if people learned their lesson from there. There's a few, you know, there's a few great examples across all of sports. I mean, I can picture clear as day the George Brett illegal pine tar on the bat at Yankee Stadium when he was playing for the Kansas City Royals. As that one goes into the glove of Lenz and he'll hang on. Every now and again, there's that one moment where, oh, there might be something there. And it's something that's very unique. You hardly ever see it. You may even never see it, especially in person, but you really do never see it in hockey.
No. Not anymore, anyway.
Well, we still have a lot of season to go, so you never know what we may see here at the Houston Fieldhouse. But anyways, Mazzotti will lean in for the draw on the side of the Engineers. We've got 12:06 to go, third period, 5-1 RPI over Mercyhurst. Faceoff controlled by Garrett Dom and the Lakers, allowing a break-in, but only for the moment. Evans backhands its way for Brackett. Brackett finds Mazzotti, top of the zone. He shoots, deflected wide of the cage. Stewart a backhand off the end boards, but Mazzotti there to try to dig it free. Here is Brackett now, a partial 2-on-1. Brackett tried to force it in front for Evans. Good defensive effort to knock that one loose, and a backhand from the aforementioned Brackett ramps up the stick, and out of play, we'll have a faceoff to the left of Matt Lenz.
Well, it seems like RPI's taken their foot off the gas somewhat. Kent is playing a solid game at this point, making sure they're doing a good job defensively and taking the offense as it comes.
Sent in front of Watson, who will handle it with the blade of his stick. Nearly turned it over. He did, and they score. Well, there's foot off the gas, Dan Fridgen, and then there's that. That's a bad mistake to let the Lakers back into this one. It's 5-2.
Well, I think he was really indecisive of what he was going to do with it and didn't realize the kind of pressure he was under. He's got lots of time. He sees both guys being covered right there, and then he just loses it. I could see him hesitating because both players had a Lakers player on them, but as you can see right now, so he can't go to the forehand, can't go to the backhand, so he kind of froze in time.
Well, the indecision ends up on the stick of Kyler Head.
And he's saying, thank you very much.
That's one of the easier ones that he's going to score in his time. Head, speaking of transfers, came from the Robert Morris program. 6 points in 23 games in the 2020-21 season, played 18 total games with this team last year, 6 points in his first as a Laker.
Probably a good thing for that line, because coming into this third period, they were all minus two.
Taken to the center line by Agnew and in. That is, I believe, if I have it right under your right arm, that fourth line there, Bannister, Head, and Esposito. So rough start to the year for them, but a good bit of luck for this fourth line here on the depth chart for the Lakers. Near chance there, but the pass from Jack Agnew would not connect. Ardanaj chips it off the near boards, but it's stolen away by Esposito. So fourth line getting another opportunity. He goes for the stuff. It would not go. Watson holds that near post. Here is Ryan Nashi at the center line. He'll allow the rest of his team to change. Jacob Lee in on the forecheck. He takes a hit. Klee for Strom for Booty, and in he comes. Near side corner, leaned on, sent back to the point. Strom whips it across for Klee, centering feed for Beaton. Would not sit. Good defensive play there by Briere. You haven't heard much from the top line with Briere and St. Ange in many moments. Here is Beaton over the line, drops the shoulder, has one hand on the stick with the puck, but all of that was knocked wide, astray, however you want to put it. Klee back to get it, and he'll nurse an icing call out of the linesman. So a faceoff headed back into the offensive end. Just over 10 minutes gone by in the third period, and the Engineers with a 3-goal lead.
We'll see what kind of life this goal has given the Lakers, as they have just under 10 minutes to score 3 goals.
Herman, Walsh, and McIsaac, the line for Dave Smith's Engineers, but it's controlled off the draw by the Lakers and taken to the blue line and through center. St. Ange's pass too far ahead for McCallion, who was in on the offense there for the moment. Back to the aforementioned McCallion, who shoots from the point, missed the net wide. Chip to the line, Walsh was nearly sprung free. Now he is, takes it one on two with a few trailers coming. Walsh on goal, in and out of the catching glove of Lenz. Another time here in this relief appearance for Lenz that he's gotten something but not everything on the save that he's making. Certainly a fascinating trend to keep an eye on. McIsaac had it knife free for the moment, but instead it's Briere who finds the defensive line, a pass just a little bit behind where Garagosh was going. Brought in the rest of the way, a shot there was blocked by Hallbauer coming through from Jonathan Bendorf. Pass coming from the defensive line did not connect with a single sweater in white and green. And instead, Kyle Hallbauer will win the race below the goal line. That is icing once more against Mercyhurst. Nothing like a couple icings to kill your momentum, wouldn't you say?
I'd say. I was just thinking, looking at the bench of the Lakers, they've got three goaltenders on this road trip.
The other being freshman Owen Say, who is quite the rap sheet in a positive way, probably not the best way to phrase that. Last season, first team NOJHL Goalie of the Year. He was a CJHL, Canadian Junior Hockey League, I would assume, Goalie of the Year finalist, and also the 2021-22 BCHL Goalie of the Year. 244 goals against average, 923 save percentage. Led his team through the playoffs. He played last year with the Salmon Arm, I believe it's Silverbacks in the BCHL. So, third goaltender on the depth chart, but definitely somebody with a good pedigree. So, I don't know, you wonder. I mean, Lenz has the experience. He, well, 10 minutes worth of experience on the roster last year, but a guy with a reputation like that, with the kind of awards, it's not going to transfer over to college hockey completely, but you wonder if at some point, depending on what happens with Tyler Harmon, maybe Owen Say gets a look from Rick Gotkin at some point. We shall see either way as these two teams will battle tomorrow. Surdy finds Evans at the line. It's backhanded the rest of the way, where Philip Waugh will get it just over the line and out to center. Smolinski finds it on his backhand. Brackett had it for the moment and lost it. Clipped a bit on the way by there by Reifenberger.
I thought that was a good play by Reifenberger, not to hammer him, because he had his head down, had no idea. Brackett had his head down, had no idea Reifenberger was there.
It's a very good point indeed. It was a vulnerable position. He had nothing but puck on the mind at the time. It's taken through there by Waugh. Nice individual effort to get some room. He makes another nice move, but will send below the goal and find his post on the point once more. Backhand pass for Norton, who's met by Mazzotti. Now 2-on-2, they battle in that far side corner. Under 8 minutes to go here, third period, 5-2 Engineers. Last goal coming midway through that second period. James McIsaac on a goal in transition. Here is Smolinski, who will skate it over center. Two, if not three on one, if they hurry. Here comes Mashey. He shoots. It gets blocked and goes back below the goal. Taken back in front. Mashey once more. He had Lenz down for the moment, but the puck just would not sit for him completely. And before all was said and done, Mickey Burns was the one who was able to take it out of harm's way.
Yeah, he would have been better off to release that puck as soon as he got it, but he tried to stick handle it and jumped over his stick.
Agnew rips it off the boards, but not out. It hits Stewart on the way through, deflected towards goal. Watson will find it, drop it, and cover up, and give no rebound. 7:05 to go, third period here at RPI. The score midway through this third. 5-2 Engineers over the Lakers. You're watching RPI Engineers Hockey on ESPN Plus.
It's the most historic conference in college hockey. It's a battle night in and night out. ECAC Hockey, an iconic conference home to 12 of the most prestigious universities and programs in the world, and showcasing the best student athletes in the sport. Top-notch facilities and arenas, incomparable traditions, passionate fans, alumni who go on to become elite professionals, leaders, and champions. ECAC Hockey, there's no experience like it.
For the love of the game, the team, or for two, Recovery Sports Grill. At Recovery Sports Grill, you'll always have courtside seats to exciting live sports coverage. And for outstanding loyalty perks, join our Hall of Fame, Recovery Sports Grill, serving up smiles every season.
.705 to go, third period here at the Houston Fieldhouse. Engineers a 5-2 lead over the Lakers on ESPN Plus here on a Friday evening. It's Dan and Dan with you, Ball and Friggin, respectively. Thanks so much for joining us. Face off one to the near side boards, but taken away there by Mason Klee. He rings it the length, but instead it's stolen and brought back to the point. One timer coming, they score! Well, Klee attempted to ring it around to the far side to get the breakout started, but it ends up on the stick of Philip Waugh, and a bomb from the point gives Waugh his first goal of the season, and it's now a two-goal game here in Troy.
That was an absolute laser. That puck came out of the net as quick as it went in the net based on how it hit the mesh, and it was top shelf all the way. I'd like to see Watson out top of his crease there with that puck at the point. He kind of got caught deep in the paint, which allowed the vulnerability of going over his glove side on the top shelf.
Waugh, the junior out of McLean, Virginia. Not necessarily known for offense last year. 14 games, just one assist, no goals. So he's on the board here. It's poked away, a two-on-one coming with McIsaac and Walsh. Here comes McIsaac, now for Walsh, and the puck wouldn't sit. Went for the saucer pass as Walsh hit the brakes, and now Walsh finds it behind the cage, a wraparound, and he loses his balance as he was trying to cut quickly to that far side. A couple of good looks here on offense for the Engineers directly after the Philip Waugh one-timer goal, but neither would go. Surdy takes it over the line. His pass would not go past the active defense of the Lakers. McIsaac able to take it away eventually. Now it's Herman who will step back into his own defensive end, taken away, but the pass looking to the point in town end was blocked. Hallbauer will take it through center. He draws a penalty. A big one taken there. It will be a slash as Hallbauer had a stick knocked out of his hands as he was skating into the center line, and a big power play up coming for the Engineers.
Well, good one. Mercyhurst had a little bit of momentum going. It is taken away with a two-minute minor to head with a slash.
Well, hockey giveth and hockey taketh away as Kyler Head, the beneficiary of the Watson mistake a few moments ago, and now he will sit for two for slashing. 14-11, the time of the penalty. Now it's sent for Mashey on the right side. Backhand feed in front, looking for Beaton. Didn't get the poke he was looking for. Booty for Surdy. For Booty once more on the left side. He steps in and shoots in a glove save. And Lenz will hang on.
Yeah, Booty with that shot. He really didn't have much traffic in front of the net. Lenz saw that shot all the way from the stick right into his glove.
The Engineers are two for two so far on the power play, but both goals have come from the other unit. No use really in designating them first and second at this point, given how much that other unit's scoring. Here is Heidemann, who wheels off the wall, a shot and a save. Rebound corralled there by Beaton on the near side. Surdy quickly for Mashey on that far side wall. He plays the bumper here on this unit. Heidemann below the goal. Center is Beaton, whiffed. Here's Mashey, and a save by Lenz. Puck is still loose. Mashey once more, switches places with Surdy, who steps in, fakes the pass, down low for Heidemann, below the goal. Heidemann for Booty. The puck not sitting quite for a one-timer caliber, but it's Booty once more, shoots, blocker save, rebound off the end boards. It's cleared by Townend, the length of the rink, and the Lakers will get a much-needed change. Well, the Engineers faithful showing their appreciation for the opposing netminder, as you can tell. Taken to the line and in by Agnew, sent back to the point now for Smolinski. Here is Lee on the near side. To the corner, it's Gagneau. Back to the point for Smolinski. Gagneau once more on the near side.
That was a first. I've never seen a chant being read from a phone.
Everybody takes notes in new ways nowadays, I tell you that. Here is Smolinski, shot from the point, deflected over the net. I believe they also use the name Tyler, which is the name of the starting netminder, who is no longer in the net, so I would recommend using the phone for the box score before the notes.
Well, I think they were saying Kyler. They were yelling at the guy that was in the box.
Oh, see, this is why I needed your ears. Backhand by Walsh, a save! Glenn's able to kick that one out. Walsh finds that rebound, though. Power play coming to a close. We'll go back to 5-on-5. Backdoor feed for Walsh. A diving play to knock it away. Power play is over. We return to 5-on-5 aside with under 4 minutes to go in the third. Good pressure in the late going on that man advantage for the Engineers, but nothing doing in their attempt to move it to 3-for-3. And now Mercyhurst will get an opportunity to calm things down. It's Waugh, and his pass is deflected in by Head, who will go for a change. Smolinski off of the stick of Brackett. Now Mazzotti and Brackett exchange. Brackett ridden off the puck into the corner there by St. Ange. Brackett finds it, but his backhand attempt was knocked to the side. Brought over the line by Briere, who will send it cross corner. 5-2 Engineers, 3 minutes to go, third period here at the Houston Fieldhouse. Sent to the point, Bisson gets it to settle for him. Here is Briere, who loses it. Tried to advance it to the front of the net. Garagosh makes a nice play, but he lost the puck in the process. Now 3-on-2, they rush. Klee at the line will send it into the corner and go for a change. Maybe not the flashy play, but probably the responsible one at this point in the game. Booty on the defensive effort is able to knock the puck away. Briere steals it back from Hallbauer, centering feed. Saved by Watson, the rebound. Covered up by the netminder for the Engineers. Bit of a defensive breakdown for RPI in the late going, but Jack Watson was able to bail them out in the crease.
That was Owen Norton, the defenseman, sitting right in front of the net, wide open. Great play by Briere to find him, and Watson comes up with a huge save when he needed it most.
The Lakers are having a quick conversation as to who will go on the ice for this very important offensive zone faceoff. Lenz is still in the crease, down by two at this point, but before anything else happens, we'll have a timeout on the ice taken by Mercyhurst. We've got 2:28 remaining in period three as the Lakers will take their timeout and will draw up a play here on offense, trailing by two. It was all Engineers for the first 40 minutes and at least the start of the third, but you know, you noted something earlier on in this period. The Engineers were kind of, it looked like they were taking the foot off the gas a little bit. It was definitely more even in play. And then a mistake by Jack Watson leads to the second goal, another goal. Now it's 5-3. It's a teaching moment, you have to think, to be able to continue through 60 minutes at that pace.
Yeah, no question. I mean, you have to make sure that you're playing a full 60 minutes. And I mean, I know you're playing a 5-1 game coming out in the third period, but you want to make sure that you know, you finish off real strong and really keep the pressure on Mercyhurst. You don't want to give them any kind of inclination that they can get back into this game, which has happened. And now we'll see how they fare out, because I'm sure Coach Godkin is going to be pulling the goaltender.
He has indeed. Lenz will go to the bench. He gets a tap on the backside from Tyler Harmon, who has been manning the defense door since about midway through the second.
I'll be looking for that one-timer from Waugh again, because he can certainly shoot the puck.
Leon Burns on the draw to the right of Watson. It's controlled by the Engineers, but stolen away. Wawa's to the near side of your screen. A one-timer coming from St. Ange at the top of the circles. That didn't connect. Now here's Waugh on the near side. 6-on-5, the Lakers play down by 2. Skated below the goal, pass to the far side, finds Briere. Briere below the goal. Now back for Briere, one-timer. Waugh, kick save by Watson. He'll control his own rebound before St. Ange is able to get there to knife it free. A big stop there by Watson and no rebound left.
Well, as I said, Waugh's looking to tee that up. You certainly have some good players out there for the Lakers. Briere, who's got the hands, he's going to be the setup guy in the half wall. You'll have guys like St. Ange in front of the net looking to create havoc and take the eyes away from the goaltender.
Briere wins the draw, but it's won a bit too convincingly out to the neutral zone past the outstretched stick of Philip Waugh. Waugh exchanges for Garagos, who is out on the point as well. The puck up in the air near the defensive blue line, but we'll have a stoppage. A hand pass quickly called. The two linesmen converging on that one. We'll have a stoppage and a faceoff, and this time the Lakers will change their personnel. The RPI Engineers will follow suit. The conversation now goes to who was against. It was actually against the Lakers. I didn't catch that originally, so
Lakers have too many men on the ice because the goaltender went back in.
Every referee in the stands made sure to catch that one too, so
yeah, really.
Control by the Engineer. Strom left for Klee, who is able to backhand it past Owen Norton, but it goes the length of the rink, and so an icing against the Engineers will put the Lakers back on the 6-5 advantage with a faceoff to the left of Watson.
Yeah, those are the ones you just want to flip up into the neutral zone, let your forwards, you know, accelerate, get the wheels going, and attack that puck as it's coming down. A little too much mustard on it.
Lee and Esposito faceoff won by the Lakers. Turned over, though, and Strom's able to backhand it. That's a little more what you're looking for. A good punt in football, a good lag putt in golf, whatever your simile you want to use in sports is, that's exactly what you're looking for with a flip like that. Taken the other way by Norton, centering feed save. Rebound loose in front of the cage. Unable to find it there. Was head in front of the net, sent all the way back to the point now for Norton, who's covering. 1:10 to go in the third. Curling off of the near side wall, that shot gets blocked, picked up by Strom, sent along the near side boards. Mashy chips it to the line, and all the way down it will go just before the line for icing. Heidemann finds it behind the net. A wraparound, he falls. The puck back on the stick of Fedulov. A little bit of life remaining here for the Lakers as they advance it over the line, but it's turned over. Lee chips to the defensive blue line and out. Whipped right back, shot at the empty net is blocked. Mashy has it once more. Here is Ryan Mashy, and he scores. Well, the Lakers gave it their best go down the stretch, but the assistant captain, Ryan Mashy, puts a bow on this one. It's 6-3 Engineers, and that should just about do it at the Houston Fieldhouse.
Well, you knew that he was going to be putting that puck in the net because there's no way. Well, I guess you could miss.
Don't put that energy out here. You never know. He was able to find it, though, in a quick move. Just to make the defender shake just a little bit, opened up that room. Ryan Mashy did the rest. 6-3 Engineers with under 40 seconds to go in the third period. An offensive outburst, to say the least, for a team that scored just 3 goals combined in their scrimmage and exhibition games last weekend. A lot to like from this offense. Here comes Briere. He's met there by Brackett. Evans ties up near the defensive blue line. It's kicked back out to center, 15 seconds to go. The fans on their feet here at the Houston Fieldhouse. At least the student section in front of us, they've been up for most of the game. They're up right now, and for good reason. 3 seconds becomes 2, and with that, the Engineers will move to 1-0 in the regular season. Thanks to a 6-3 victory over the Mercyhurst University Lakers, in front of a happy crowd that will drive home as such here from the Houston Fieldhouse. Your final thoughts on a season-opening victory here in their non-conference schedule for this Engineers team?
Well, you just saw one guy for RPI, Jacob Lee, step up. He had 2 goals and 3 assists, 5 points tonight for him, and just a great way to start off the non-conference regular season with the games that count. And that's the type of leadership you're looking for, and I know Coach Smith is looking for from, you know, the upperclassmen for him to come out and play a game like this. And, you know, I think they came out real early, caught the, I think they were still on the bus, Mercyhurst. you know what, hey, they finish it off. They don't really win the third period, they lose the third period 2-1, but I'm sure it's something they can continue to build on, and we'll be looking for another barn burner here tomorrow night.
Final shots on goal, 35-34 in favor of Mercyhurst. The winning net for Jack Watson for the Engineers. He makes 32 saves en route to his first victory of the year. Well, if you like what you saw tonight, don't worry. We're going to do it again in 24 hours' time. Join Dan Bridgen and myself tomorrow night on ESPN Plus as these two teams do battle once more to finish off the opening weekend for the Engineers. For everybody working hard behind the scenes and for my broadcast partner, Dan Bridgen, Dan Ball saying thank you so much for watching the final score for the final time. The RPI Engineers double up the Mercyhurst Lakers by a score of 6-3. Thanks so much for watching and have a good evening. You've been watching RPI Engineers Hockey on ESPN Plus.